más differentiate, one must differentiate two types of colonial encounters. The colonial encounter in the New World, in which the Iberian conquistadores were not only able to colonize the territories, but actually to conquer spiritually the population. There was a spiritual conquest. The population was also forcefully confessionalized, although the Catholic confessionalization of Latin American peoples was not as thorough, if you wish, or is not as forceful as the European one. And so this may explain why today Latin America has not followed the process of Latin Catholic secularization, but actually in the last 60 years, we've seen a tremendous explosion of religious pluralism through Latin America that we'll, I will analyze a bit at the end of the lecture today. The other colonial encounter was with people that were as powerful, if not more, than the Europeans. This was also the age of the gunpowder empires, the Muslim gunpowder empires, and the Iberian conquistadors were in no position, or no European power, was the time in a position to conquer any of the Muslim empires, the Mughal, the Persian, the Ottoman, nor the Chinese Empire, of course, nor any of the kingdoms of Southeast Asia, Japan, Vietnam, etc. So it was, in this respect, not so much a colonization controlled by the West, but intercultural encounters among relatively equal peoples and powers. But this makes it especially important, precisely because this was, if you wish, globalization before Western hegemony. And my claim is that we are entering a phase of globalization after Western hegemony, and there are aspects of these first encounters which I consider very relevant for the future development of global intercultural processes. Now, of course, the Jesuit Catholic missionary impulse had, as a matter of fact, the hegemonic purpose of universal conversion to the true Catholic faith. In fact, as stated in the formula of the Institute, there are 1539 foundational charter. Jesuits took an oath, and I'm quoting from the charter, to travel to any part of the world where there was hope of God's greater service and the God of souls in order to minister, first of all, to the Turks. This was the original intentions of the Jesuits in Montmartre when they got together the seven original members to go to the Holy Land to be missionaries among Muslims. So to the Turks or any other infidels, even those who live in the regions called the Indies, or any heretics whatever, or schismatics, or any of the faith. So it was clearly a universal mission to all of humanity. It indicates the global mobility. The world is our home. Jerónimo Nadal, the great assistant of Ignacio de Loyola, would say, the world is truly our home. Global mobility was culturally encoded, as it were, into the makeup of the Jesuit order from its inception. Clearly, the Jesuits initiated their mission with a traditional and customary distinction between vera religio, namely the true Christian faith or Catholic religion, and all others, Christians, schismatics, and heretics, Jewish and Muslim infidels, and the remaining pagans and idolaters. In this respect, the Jesuits never challenged the discriminatory distinction between true and false religion. But what makes Jesuit global missionary practice particularly relevant is the fact that under certain circumstances, their controversial method of accommodation took a form which we would call today nativist enculturation. One should avoid, of course, anachronistic interpretations of early modern Jesuit practices from our contemporary global perspectives of cultural and religious pluralism. Nevertheless, Balignano's method of accommodation points to a formula of globalization that rejects unidirectional westernization and opens itself to multicultural encounters and reciprocal learning processes. In some cases, what began as a one-way mission of Christian evangelization that assumed the exclusivity of Christianity as the true religion and the superiority of Christian European culture turn into a mutual intercultural and interreligious encounter that again, under certain circumstances, transform the missionary as well as the native. The more the Jesuit missionaries were on their own and in the peripheries, without the support and protection of the Iberian colonial powers, the more favorable became the circumstances for an open-ended, non-hierarchic interaction and a genuine dialogue. Particularly in the encounter with the multifaceted so-called religions, they were not religions yet, and they didn't use the term religions themselves, the Jesuits, of Asia, the all category of pagan, heathen, or infidel began to collapse, and a new plural system of what today we would call world religions began to appear. I'm going to offer illustrations from the Jesuit encounters with the culture and religions of Japan and China, although one could extend the same analysis to the encounters of Roberto de Nobile with Hindu Brahmins in Madurai, to the encounters of Hippolyto Desideri with Tibetan Buddhism, or to the Jesuit encounters with the diverse indigenous cultures of the Americas, from Quebec to Tierra del Fuego. Japan is undoubtedly the most interesting case. Francis Xavier and the Jesuits arrived in feudal war in Japan in 1549, sponsored by the Portuguese Padroado. Yet once in Japan, the Jesuit padres could go where Portuguese merchants and soldiers had no access, and started the process of cultural and religious encounters that shaped what has been named the Christian century in Japan, roughly from 1499 to the 1620s, when Christianity was really begun to be persecuted and erased. The high number of Japanese Christians, which are estimated anywhere from 300,000 to 1 million, from all walks of life, from the highest daimyos to the lowest outcasts, in itself was significant. But more significant than the number of Christians was the impact that the encounter with Western Christianity, or rather with Catholic Europe, because this was really an encounter with Catholic Europe, had on Japanese culture and on the determined effort of the Tokugawa regime, not only to repress and to exterminate Christianity, but to erase any memory of the previous encounter and to construct an authentic Japanese culture purified of any hybrid accretion from the Christian West. Sengoku Japan, the country at war, was undergoing at the time a radical transformation from a feudal warring system to a centralized absolutist state, and the Kirishiten, the Christians, played an important catalyst role in this transformation. From a comparative historical perspective, what is striking about absolutist state formation in Japan is the role played by the ethno-religious cleansing of the Christian minority by anti-Christian state ideology and by the confessionalization of the entire Japanese population through the new Buddhist and Shinto temple registration system first introduced in 1635. The state-enforced disciplinary effort continued through the institutionalization of the so-called Christian Aratame. If you've seen the movie Silence, in which everybody was forced to basically step their foot on any kind of Christian image, practices through the second half of the 17th century, after Christianity had been wiped out, required Japanese to prove that they were not Christian. As the Japanese historian Kiri Paramore points out, quote, the establishment of this system represented much, much more than just an instance of anti-Christian activity. It established an institutionalized system of social control extending to the entire population, a system of control that continued to function until the end of the Tokugawa shogunate in the late 19th century. Striking is the fact that the persecution of Japanese Christianity happened after the Jesuits had been expelled, and the state enforced anti-Christian measures to erase any memory of the Christian century were implemented after all Japanese Christians had been exterminated, had apostatized, or were driven underground for several centuries. In this respect, the anti-Christian message had the character of a negative confessionalization. In order to homogenize the entire Japanese population, indeed, making them authentically Japanese. Later interpretations by Japanese as well as by Western scholars have taken this Tokugawa Japanese ideology for granted as an explanation for the ultimate failure of the Jesuits and of Christianity in Japan, as well as a justification for the radical isolationist policies of the Sakoku, the closed country Japan introduced by the Tokugawa. It has been interpreted as the need to protect Japan, not only from a foreign and a Japanese religion, but from Western colonialism. Catholic Christianity had been rejected naturally as a dangerous foreign body, which besides being an inferior and questionable form of Christianity, and this was the Protestant interpretation, was essentially other, and therefore ultimately unassimilable, without undermining Japanese culture and Japanese identity. The argument presupposes that the national Japanese culture and identity was already firmly fixed and not subject to change at the time of the colonial encounter with European Catholic culture. One could present the alternative hypothesis. The Japanese culture at the time was rather fluid and open, and the reconstruction of Christianity as the radically other played a crucial role in the process of constructing a Japanese national identity in the first place. This identity could now be projected onto the remote prehistorical past of Japan as a unique, particularistic, unchangeable Japanese essence. The interesting thing about the Christian century is not so much the number of Japanese converts and the extent to which Japanese seem to be open to a radical change in religious identity. More interesting is the fact that the material, textual, and pictorial evidence that remains from the Christian century, mainly in Western archives, because Japanese archives were purified of any Christian presence, shows how fluid, open, and hybrid Japanese culture had become. Japanese art, particularly painting, fashion and dress codes, food, language, and even the most Japanese of rituals, the tea ceremony, had been significantly transformed by the encounter between the Jesuits and Japanese culture. One can, of course, interpret the isolationist policies of Sakoku regime as the first prototypical anti-colonial and anti-imperialist fundamentalist nativist rejection of Western globalization. The problem with such interpretation is not only that more recent revisionist histories have questioned the radical fundamentalist character of the Sakoku isolationist closure, but more importantly, that it implies an anachronistic reading of the fear of Western colonialism before Western hegemony, at a time when neither the Portuguese nor the Spaniards were in a position to colonize Japan. In fact, it was a time when Japan was initiating an aggressive expansionist maritime policy under Toyotomi Hideyoshi, which anticipated later pan-Asian Japanese imperialism. The attempt to invade Korea twice with Japanese armies, some of which were led by Christian daimyos carrying Christian standards of Christ and the Virgin Mary, as well as other Japanese excursion overseas, proved ultimately abortive and were reversed by the Tokugawa Sakoku policy. Rather than the Iberian colonial powers representing a real military threat to Japan, the preeminent historian of the period, C.R. Boxer, offers a radically different hypothesis, namely that were it not for the reversal of the Tokugawa state policy, and I quote, the Japanese, whether peacefully or otherwise, would have established themselves in the Philippines, they already had started business with them, Indochina, and in parts of Indonesia by the turn of the 17th century, and they would in all probability have been able to share in the fruits of Europe's industrial revolution for several decades before they actually did. Global history could have been radically different. The importance of just what if conjunctural historical hypothesis is to challenge our modernist, teleological, and Eurocentric assumptions concerning the process of globalization. We tend to assume, in my view erroneously, a certain teleology of the systemic structures of globalization by capitalism and by Western colonialism. But early modern globalization from the 16th to the 18th century did not have yet global systemic structures, neither economic, political, or cultural. It is a globalization better characterized by globally connected histories. It is a globalization before Western hegemony, based on global encounters between cultures and societies, which in Asia at least were still relatively equal. The Jesuit attitude of accommodation to Asian cultures reflects precisely such a relative symmetry. Certainly, Jesuits were convinced of the superiority of Christianity over other religions. But this is not translated, as will happen in the 19th century, into a perception of the superiority of Western culture to Kurd. In fact, some of the more open-minded Jesuits recognized that Japanese culture was in many respects superior to their own European culture. So when the Japanese called the Spaniards or the Portuguese barbarians, they were right. Alessandro Balignano's method of accommodation was, of course, grounded on the realization that they could never succeed in their mission to convert the Japanese to Christianity unless they themselves made an effort to adopt a Japanese habitus. But this should not be read in purely instrumentalist terms, but rather as an expression of a true openness to the culture of the other, which was grounded in a genuine respect for that culture. The history of modern Japan can be interpreted and understood differently if one takes into account this early modern global encounter with the Jesuits. Japan represents the first non-European absolutist secular state that developed not in imitation to the West, or consciously following the principles of Hobbes' Leviathan, yet following a pattern similar and parallel to the European confessional states. The Tokugawa state itself was non-confessional, and in this respect it could be characterized as secular, yet it introduced a policy of confessionalization of its population by enforcing the registration of every Japanese subject in Buddhist, mainly, also in Shinto temples, akin to the European parish registration system. Again, what was important was not that everybody had to become Buddhist, but that everybody had to become Japanese, as defined by the state. The aim of the anti-Christian state crusade, which continued for a century after the expulsion of the Jesuits and other Catholic missionaries, and after Japanese Christians had ceased to exist publicly, was not the establishment of Buddhist religion per se, but the Japanization of the population. Buddhism was only a national instrument of Japanization. After the Meiji Restoration, the Japanese state easily switched from Buddhism to nationalist Shinto in order to enforce an even more rigid policy of Japanization while renewing again its anti-Christian ideology at the end of the 19th century. It was the moment when the modern Western concept of religion became incorporated into Japanese consciousness through the neologism Shukyo. This is the name of religion, modern religion in Japanese, Shukyo. An old term that actually signifies a Buddhist sect. Shukyo, or religion in modern Japanese, has therefore the connotation precisely of a sectarian group. For that very reason, the Meiji regime insisted that Shinto was not a religion, but simply Japanese national culture that should be enforced by the state, while tolerating the freedoms of all kinds of particularist sectarian religions, including Buddhist sects and Christian sects. Moving to a second illustration of the Jesuit encounter with Chinese culture and religions in the early modern era, it is obvious that China represented a very different type of colonial encounter. China was a huge empire, stable and relatively pacified, governed by a civil imperial bureaucracy of culture literati. Yet the Jesuit method of accommodation was also introduced with relative success, first under the Ming Dynasty and later continued under the Qing Dynasty. But it's important to stress that the accommodation was not a common strategy devised by European Jesuits. The practice emerged out of the intercultural encounter itself. In Japan, as well as in China, it was their local friends, the first Christians who taught the Jesuits the need to go native and to accommodate the local culture if they wanted to succeed. It was his friend and disciple Chu Ju Kuei, or Chi Tsai Shu, who first convinced Matteo Ricci of the need to abandon the habit of a Buddhist monk, which he had adopted first upon entering China with Michele Ruggieri, and to assume instead the habitus of a Mandarin scholar, Jew. The ultimate goal of Ricci and the Jesuits who followed him was to penetrate the imperial court of Beijing and to convert the Chinese emperor. The Constantinian model of imperial conversion from above was indeed taken for granted by the European Catholics. But Ricci soon realized that he had to become first Chinese before the Chinese could possibly become Christians. He demanded an arduous enterprise of double translation, of translation of Latin texts and of European culture into Chinese, and of translation of Chinese texts and Chinese culture into Latin and into European culture. Ricci himself, through his own sinicization, becoming Chinese, and he became an authentic Confucian scholar, recognized by all the Confucian scholars as one of their own. Indeed, probably that knew the Confucian literature better than most of them. Ricci's translation of Euclid's Elements, again mathematics, into Chinese, of course the strategy of bringing Western science and technology was very clear. His treatise on friendship, introducing famous aphorisms from Greek, Latin, and Christian authors into Chinese, again as Renaissance humanists. Of course they had themselves made out of the Greek and Latin scholars saints, which they would adopt into their own gymnasium or liberal arts colleges. His catechism, Tien Shu Shi Yi, True Meaning of the Lord of Heaven, and most of importantly, his world map of the myriad nations of the earth, fusing Western and Chinese cartography. And this map, again, that truly fuses, is made by both. It incorporates the Western techniques of cartography and Chinese. For the first time, it gives names, Chinese names, to every European city and country, which are still used today by the Chinese, by the Japanese, by the Koreans. But most importantly, it decenters both. The center of heaven, China is not at the center of the map, and Europe is not at the center of the map. The map, the center is almost kind of Japan, so that China is west, and actually Latin America and Europe is east. And this, of course, is a way of radically changing the dynamic of precisely either Western centrism or Sinocentrism, which was so central to Chinese culture. The effect of the translation of Chinese classics and culture first into Latin and then into European languages and cultures, mediated primarily by the China Jesuits, was probably even more crucial for European historical developments. Ricci and other Jesuits play a crucial role in the manufacturing of Confucius, you have books, the manufacturing of Confucianism, and in their significant reception in 17th and 18th centuries. But again, the name Confucius itself is an invention of Ricci. There's not Kunzi, but not Confuzi. It was Ricci that invented the term, and this is the way in which has been Confucianism, of course, is now taken over by the Chinese themselves as a principle. But it's important to stress that this dual and reciprocal process of enculturation, which crystallized in a novel form of Confucian Christianity or Christian Confucianism, was the result of synthetic collaboration and intercultural dialogue between European Jesuits and Chinese scholars, such as Yang Tingyun, and excuse if anybody here, phonetically Chinese, I have no idea, Li Qi Cao, and Xu Guang Qi, widely known as the three pillars of Christianity in China. Jacques Gernet, the great French xenologist, famously argued that those Chinese scholars were not truly Christian because they did not know the true European Christianity, but only the one given to them by Ricci. Moreover, for Gernet, the whole encounter was based on fundamental misunderstandings between two supposedly incommensurable cultures and conceptions of religion. But Gernet's evaluation is based on a post-Enlightenment secularist conception of Christian religion and on a modern essentialist conception of Western and Chinese civilizations as fixed and radically different totalities. Ricci's account of Chinese religion and culture and its reception in Europe was to prove particularly relevant. A well-known paragraph from Ricci's 1588 letter to Juan Bautista Román may serve as illustration. I'm going to translate freely from the Italian, Portuguese, Spanish Creole, frequently used by Jesuits in East Asia. Ricci writes, "Let me say a few words about the religions and sects in China." And they use, once they use religion, other time they use sects, other laws, other teaching. There is no clear yet name. Those names, teachings, laws, religions, faiths, are interchangeable. About the religion and sects of China, without being too precise, since there is no religion in China, meaning they have no true religion, and the small amount of cult that exists is so intricate that even their own religious people, namely their monks, cannot give a good account of it. Leaving aside the Moors, the Muslims, which I do not know how they got here, he says, the Chinese are divided into three sects. One is called Hejia, referring to the Buddhist, the other Zilitan, referring to the Taoist, and the most celebrated is the one of the literati who normally do not believe in the immortality of the soul, make fun of the assertions of the other two, and only give thanks to heaven and earth for the benefits they receive, but do not pray for salvation in the afterlife. In another letter of 1609 to Francesco Passio, a fellow Jesuit, Ricci wrote, "In ancient times, the Chinese followed the law, the natural law, more faithfully than in our own countries. And 1500 years ago, this people was not inclined to the worship of idols. On the contrary, the books of the literati, which are the most ancient and authoritative among their writings, do not adore anything but heaven and earth, and the Lord of both. And if we examine those books, we will find little therein against the light of reason, and much that is in conformity with it, and we can hope in divine mercy, and that many of their ancient sages were saved by their observance of the natural law with the help that God would have given them on account of their goodness." End of quote. Leaving aside the accuracy of Ricci's interpretation of Confucianism and his negative views of Buddhism and Taoism, two things become evident from this passage. First, in the encounter with the religious other, Jesuits are confronted with forms of religious pluralism which could not easily be defeated within the traditional taxonomies of false pagan or idolatrous religions. Secondly, in their recourse to natural law and the right of reason, in order to account for the nature of this religious pluralism, the Jesuits initiate, in fact, a form of intercultural interreligious encounter that takes place without reference to revelation. In a certain sense, one finds here the seeds of the two types of pluralism which Berger pointed out, multi-religious pluralism and secular religious pluralism. In retrospect, re-examining the Jesuit encounters, we can certainly assume that the Christian impact in China was probably much less relevant and certainly less lasting than the Chinese impact on Christian Europe. The Jesuit translation introduction of Chinese culture into the European public sphere, particularly as it was mediated through the Chinese rights controversy, played a crucial role in shaping what became the Enlightenment critique of religion and in this respect affected the European process of secularization. Crucial was the distinction that Jesuit introduced in China between religion and culture. Between, on the hand, universal Christian religion, which per se is non-European, and therefore can become enculturated in any and all particular cultures, and on the other, those components of the particular religious cultures, which are idolatrous, and therefore cannot become Christianized. Those idolatrous components of culture have to be rejected. However, those components of culture which are not idolatrous, which are civil rather than religious, as they call them, as Ricci calls them, are neutral and therefore can become Christianized. That is the way in which Confucianism, as interpreted by the Jesuits, was understood not as an idolatrous religion, but as a humanist culture, as a natural morality, and as a civil cult. Unintentionally, once the distinction was incorporated into European debates, it signaled the beginning of the breakdown of the monotheistic distinction between true and false religion on which the entire structure of Christendom had been based. The distinction between religion and culture was the core of the Chinese rites controversy. Other Catholic missionaries, Dominicans, Franciscans, and the curial officers at Propaganda Fide rejected the Jesuit interpretation of the Chinese rites as cultural civic rites, insisting that they were idolatrous religious rituals which Chinese Christians had to reject. However, the European philosophers, Voltaire among them, accepted the Jesuit distinction but turned it against them and against Christianity and all revealed faith religions. Having learned from the Jesuits that Confucianism represented a kind of deist natural religion before revelation, they gladly affirmed those elements of the Chinese rites, which the Jesuits interpreted as civic customs, not as religion, to insist that this is what was needed in Europe. A deist natural religion based on civic customs, while rejecting the supernatural faith superstitious rites of revealed Christian religion. Confucian culture, the philosophers thought, was indeed superior to Christian religion. This explains the Chinese craze of the European Enlightenment and of theism. They could recognize the superiority of Chinese Confucian culture over European Christian culture. In the 19th century, with the triumph of Western colonialism and secular modernity, the European attitude toward China and all Oriental civilizations radically changed. Now, the hegemonic military and technological superiority of industrial capitalism and political and economic liberalism prove the superiority of modern Western civilization over traditional Asian cultures and justified the imperial white man's burden and its mission civilizatrice. Ultimately, the Jesuit project failed. It failed because they were fighting with the competing royal multiple Catholic projects, the French, the Portuguese, and the Spaniard, who wanted to control the missions. And of course, with the formation of the Propaganda Fide by the 1620s, almost 100 years after the Jesuits, to take away the missions from both, from the kings and from the Jesuits, then ultimately we have an alternative model of global Catholic Romanization, making everybody Roman Catholic to Latinize, not to have separate Japanese, Chinese, etc. Catholicisms. I'm going to finish now very briefly with a brief, we all know the story of the United States. The United States, of course, is interesting because it's the place in which all the ethno-religious minorities that had to flee the process of confessionalization in Europe found ultimately refuge, or the sects or the religious minorities. But it's also the first place in which the two roads, the road of inter-religious encounter, colonial encounter, is after all also the place not only of refuge of European religious minorities, but also the place of the native religions of all the Americans, and the place, of course, of the religions of the African slaves that brought them to the Americas. But it's also, of course, the place of the Enlightenment insofar as the American Revolution is a child of the European Enlightenment and is the first modern secular state. And, of course, the Latin American republics follow very soon thereafter. So it is the place, the new world, in which the two roads, the European road of secularization and the intercultural colonial road, come together. We all know, of course, that the first secular state does not bring the secularization of the population, but actually insofar as there was no previous deconfessional, no previous confessionalization, because the American state is born as a secular state without having been first a Christian state, there is also no process of deconfessionalization. On the contrary, along with the development of American history, we have actually the growth of religions in Pentecostal, Protestant religions, Protestant denominations in the US. And it comes, churching is not something from which people flee with modernity, but something that comes with modern modernist mobilization. We have data at most 20, even where you have the colonial established churches, the Congregational Church in New England, the Presbyterian Church in the Mid-Atlantic States, the Anglican Church in the South, at most 20% of the population belonged to those churches. So there was no enforced confessionalization. The majority were unchurched, and they became church through process of religious awakening that were part of modern mobilization, along with political democracy and economic mobilization. So the key to the American model is the dissolution of the national church institution and the institutionalization of the sectarian model of voluntary associations. And so the model is denominationalism. We'll talk about denominationalism tomorrow in the final lecture. We all know that the United States through immigration, you have continuous growth of new religions, basically despite in the last decades, we have for the first time evidence that a vast group of among the population, the nones, those who are actually without religious affiliation, is growing. Probably today, close to 20% of the population declare themselves in the US nones. People, my colleagues in sociology, that basically support the theory of secularization, you see, finally the United States is becoming modern and secularized. Well, I would say, for me, what was, and again, I have to admit that it took me a long, long time as a European, when I came to the United States, to understand American religion, because I assume that the religion is a very traditional thing. And only when I realized that American religion is not a traditional thing, a residue from the past, but it's a product of American modernity, I realized that there is no need for it to disappear. Of course, it's transformed. It's been transformed today. And there are much more secular options today in America than there were 20 years ago. But at least the majority of the population remains very, very religious. What's most interesting for me, and with this I'm going to finish, is the transformation of Latin American societies. That they have gone dramatically from being, again, a homogeneous religious Catholic continent to, basically, explosion of religious polarization. It's interesting to compare Quebec and Brazil in the last 60 years. Quebec, that before the so-called Silent Revolution, was by far the most religious society of North America, in one single generation has become the most secular. Basically, people have moved away from the Catholic Church to the secular Quebecois nation. In fact, in the last referendum, the only correlation between voting for independence or not was neither class, nor income, nor education, nor gender, nor urban, rural, but how frequently do you go to church? If you go to church, you do not vote for independence. If you do not go to church, you vote for independence. So the way in which Catholicism, that was the identity of Quebecois nationalism before, has disappeared and has been taken over by secular nationalism, isn't it striking? In the case of Brazil, we have evidence that since the 60s, you have a process that is radical deconfessionalization. The Catholic population has gone from about 90-some-odd% to 60-some-odd%. And of course, we don't have really measures, but the trend is very clear. Decrease of the Catholic majority, radical increase of Protestant minorities, a relative increase, but very relative mild, of a secular option, in the case of Brazil, around 9%, as opposed to the 25% Pentecostals and Protestants. And in the last two decades, the beginning growth of other religions, which include, of course, the Afro-Brazilian religions, but also Amerindian religions, and since Latin American societies have been immigrant societies also for many, many decades. You have also all the immigrant religions, Muslims, Japanese, Chinese, Hindus, etc. And you have now, for the first time, the conversion also of Latin Americans to all of those non-Christian religions. And, of course, the emergence, especially in Brazil, of new religions which have emerged in the last 50 years, and which are what we will call new religious movements or cults. Brazil is an extreme case, but the trend is general for Latin America. No Latin American country escapes the trends, these four trends: decrease of the Catholic majority, increase of the Protestant minorities, increase of the secular option, very mild option in most part, and a slow increase of other religions. If within the Christian West you have these two radically different models, American Protestant secularization is radically different from the Nordic European, and Latin American secularization is radically different from the Latin Catholic European, then one can expect in the rest of the world the dynamics of secularization are as diverse as those you find both within Europe and between Europe and the Americas. And so next time, in the lecture tomorrow, I hope to conclude by showing how these two roads, the secular road of globalization, globalization of the secular immanent frame, the globalization of secular institutions, and accompanied by religious transformation of all kinds and by new global flows, is leading to an intertwining of the two roads in a way which the world is simultaneously becoming more secular and more religious.